Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Edward Hopper, Exploring the American Realist Painter, a professional development webinar sponsored by America in Class from the National Humanities Center. I'm Richard Schramm. I'm the Vice President for Education Programs at the Center, and I'll be moderating this evening's session. Before we get underway, let me tell you a little bit about the National Humanities Center. It is located in Research Triangle Park, North Carolina, and it is the country's only independent institute for advanced study in all branches of the humanities. What that simply means is that the main program of the center is a fellowship program that brings scholars from this country and abroad to the center for an academic year to write on subjects in history, literature and language studies, philosophy, criticism of the arts, those sorts of topics. The center is distinctive among institutes for advanced study in that it has maintained now for over 30 years an active program of outreach to pre-collegiate teachers. You folks have discovered our webinars. If you go to americainclass.org, that will land you on this page. And from here, you can discover all of the other resources that the National Humanities Center offers for teachers of American history and literature. Also, you might want to check out our Pinterest page. There we aggregate our materials plus those from other sources, and we provide you valuable information that you can use in your lessons in history and literature. Please check us out on Facebook as well. You'll find out what's going on at the center there. And also there, we point you to other resources that you can use in your field and something new from us, a monthly newsletter that will keep you up to date on our new offerings and on news from the center. Many of you probably received our April newsletter, our second edition. I hope you've opened it and looked at it. And those of you who are new to us are on our mailing list, and you'll be receiving our newsletter in the future. Now, tonight, when our webinar is over, I hope you go back to the Edward Hopper homepage, the website that we developed for this program. There you will find a recording of the program and the PowerPoint, and please feel free to use the PowerPoint in your classes. That's what it's there for. You'll also find an evaluation. Fill that out for us, send it back, and you will be able to download a certificate of participation that you will be able to take to your local certifying authority to obtain whatever recertification credit your participation in this program warrants. How do you participate? Well, throughout the evening now, our seminar leader will be making comments about Edward Hopper. We'll be stopping from time to time to raise questions. And we hope you'll respond to those questions by putting your cursor in the long, narrow, white box down there at the lower right-hand side of your screen, typing in your response, hitting that send button, and your response will appear in the large chat box above. I'll be bringing your comments and questions into the seminar at appropriate moments throughout the evening, but don't wait for us to ask a question. If you have a comment or a question of your own, please put that in the chat box, send it in, and I'll bring that into the conversation when I can. The golden rule of our webinars is that the more you participate, the better the webinar. So let's get underway. We have with us tonight Gail Levin, Distinguished Professor of Art History, American Studies, and Women's Studies at the Graduate Center and Baruch College of the City College of New York. She's written widely on 20th century art, particularly on Edward Hopper. And there you see her credentials for Hopper. She put together the catalogue raisonné, which is a collection, an authoritative and definitive collection of all of the works that Hopper did. So if any scholar is going to work on Edward Hopper, that's where they start. That is the definitive and authoritative word on Hopper. So we are very pleased to have Gail with us tonight. Let me turn on her microphone and turn the program over to her. Gail, why is Edward Hopper the American Realist Painter?
This is Gail Levin, and I do want to point out that I am not on the faculty at City College, but at City University of New York, of which City College is a part, but I'm not there. I'm at Baruch College in the Graduate Center. Now, what was the question? Why is Edward Hopper a great American painter?
Well, Gail, that was our lead-in question. I'm sure you're going to be answering that throughout the program tonight, so why don't we... Well, there we go, Gail. I hope you can hear me now. That was my lead-in question. Okay, I hope you can hear me now.
Now, I had lost contact, sorry.
Okay, good. That happens from time to time. I don't know what it is, maybe sunspots or something. But that was my lead-in question. You're going to be answering that all evening long, so why don't we move ahead to your framing questions that will get us into our topic this evening.
Thank you. Am I supposed to be moving it?
Yes, Gail, you're supposed to hit that. There we go. I just did it for you. You're running the board, so there are the framing questions. Take it away.
My internet connection is very slow, Richard. You might have to be moving a lot. Okay, so we're going to talk about what it means to say that Edward Hopper was a realist painter. How do his paintings reflect the time in which they were painted, how they relate to literature and the cinema, how they are autobiographical, and indeed they are. We're going to talk about his most famous picture, Nighthawks, and ask why it's the most famous. So let's move ahead. To say he's a realist painter, all of the pictures, we can immediately understand something about what's going on. But I want to remind everyone that the meaning in Edward Hopper is much greater than what we immediately understand.
Gail, I'm sorry, I have to interrupt you for a moment. Some of our people are having a hard time hearing you. So if we could go up to that microphone icon at the top of your screen and click on that down-pointing arrow, you should see a little thing that says adjust my microphone volume.
But it's not going down again.
Okay. We've had some problems with the connection tonight, ladies and gentlemen. We'll try to solve that, but maybe you want to turn the volume up on your speakers at home. Turn them up as loud as they can go. I'm hearing...
Now I'm getting adjust microphone volume. It's not...
Okay. Hit on that. Okay, hit that and slide your microphone volume up all the way. Sorry for the delay, folks. Technology is a wonderful thing when it works. Okay, Gail, do we have that up? Oh. Well, we just lost Gail. All right, let's see if we can find her. There we go. Okay, Gail. You're back. See if we can get that microphone working. I'm sorry about this delay, folks. Gail, if you can. Gail was experiencing some difficulties with her internet connection earlier today, and I think they have come back to curse us this evening. Let's see if we can get those things working. I would fill the dead air by singing, ladies and gentlemen, but that would chase you all away. So I won't do that. Okay. Let's see. My colleague Libby Taylor is typing in. Maybe she has some good news. Okay, she's pointing to Gail's website. Let's see. Hey, Gail, if you can hear us. She was having trouble earlier this evening connecting her audio, and apparently that has happened again. Okay, let me see if I can get in touch with her by phone. Folks, I'm going to mute my microphone for a moment, see if I can call her up. And we'll see what we can do. Okay. Libby, if you'll monitor that and see if Gail comes back in while I'm on the phone, we'll get this working. And again, folks, I apologize for this. Okay, folks, we can blame all of this on Time Warner. Gail's connections are in New York City, and Time Warner has not been a very good internet service provider up there. So she is going to go to another computer and see if that works better. In the meantime, we'll sit here and wait till she gets back on. And if anyone knows any good jokes, you want to type through on the chat here. We can wait. We're going to run a little late tonight. I apologize for that, but it should be good. I see some folks are typing in. I know all of you have taught with technology before, and you know how unreliable it can be. My husband's on the phone with Time Warner right now, and he isn't happy. Well, I'm with him. I'm not happy either. So I hope you can feel our pain, Linda. Sympathize with us. So we have some other folks typing in. The first time I saw Nighthawks was in the Masterpiece board game. That's not surprising. That is so widely reproduced. One of the questions we're going to ask tonight is, why is it so popular? Why is it so, yes, I don't remember that one, but certainly we've all seen Nighthawks, we've all seen it parodied. Hopper stuff is ubiquitous. It is so American. We've all seen it, and half the time we didn't even know we were looking at it. Oh, yeah, okay, Karen, we are old. You know that game, Masterpiece Board Game. That must have been before my time. There we go. Maybe we should see if we can get an online version of that. That might be a good way to teach the masterpieces. But Nighthawks and so many of his paintings that take you through a window looking at a couple in a room who are together in that room and yet still alone. And we'll learn why he painted that tonight, if we can get our seminar leader back online. Let's see, where do we have people from tonight? We're located here in North Carolina. Where are y'all from? Okay, I see my colleague Libby is typing in. Connecticut? Oh, okay. Libby doesn't know what, her children don't know what board games are. Well, they're very little, and they'll learn. Upstate New York, L.A., and we're all over the place. Virginia, good. Another one from New York. Alaska, you get the award for being the farthest away. We have to talk real loud to get to you. East Chicago, Indiana, okay. Let's see, where else? Massachusetts, Central Texas, Miami. This is wonderful. We knew we got around the country. I'm delighted. Indiana. Are they hiring in Alaska? Always, I'm sure, yeah. Have to like cold weather. Okay. Gail's typing in. All right. Yeah, Libby is a fellow Hoosier. She grew up out there in Indiana. And then went on to, I think, went to Pennsylvania and now is a Tar Heel. And I hope all of you are sympathetic to the Tar Heels after having suffered that terrible loss Monday night. I hope we have some sympathy out there for the Heels. Yes, close game. Man, that was a shocker. It was, I know. Things were very bleak here in Chapel Hill Tuesday morning. Okay, let me get back in touch with our seminar leader and see what our status is here. See if we can move this along. I'll be right back. Okay. Join. Nothing happens. Okay. All right. Let me just make sure. I think we have you as a presenter, and you're clicking on the down pointing arrow.
Okay, the problem was there was another box up there. All right, now is that going to be loud enough for doing?
See, we'll see. Hang on the phone. Okay, folks, theoretically we have Gail back. Gail, your microphone is turned on. Why don't you?
Good evening. Can you hear me now?
Okay, folks, can we? Everybody can everyone hear Gail? Yes. Oh, that's what I want to hear. Gail, thank you for your patience. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience. And Gail, let us begin again. The framing questions for our Edward Hopper seminar. What are we going to be thinking about tonight?
What does it mean to say that Edward Hopper was a realist painter? How do we know that his paintings reflect the time in which they were painted? How do they relate to literature and the cinema? How are his paintings autobiographical? Why is Nighthawks his most famous painting? Why is it so often parodied? And why are all the paintings we're looking at significant? I've chosen some of my favorites for tonight. I have to scroll down here. So, shall I say a few words about Edward Hopper's biography?
Yes, yes. We can.
I'm also his biographer. And, you know, I was so attached to Edward Hopper that when I finished killing him off when he had to die in the 650 pages, I wept. Well, he was born in Nyack, New York in 1882, just north of New York City, into a strict Baptist family. He was rebellious as a young man already, and he wanted to go and study art, but his parents were worried he couldn't make a living. His father was a general store shopkeeper, owner. So Edward studied illustration for 2 years, and then one of his classmates goaded him to take up painting, but he always wanted to be a painter. And so that's what he became. He was at the New York School of Art, studying with William Merritt Chase, a rather conservative artist, and then a favorite teacher named Robert Henry showed up. All the students loved Henry. After art school, Edward finished. He spent more time there than usual for most students. And at the very end, he was teaching a little bit there. But in 1906, he made his first trip to Europe, going to Paris, where he lived with his parents had set it up with a family with the Baptist mission. So a kind of conservative place to live in Paris, but he wasn't at all living a conservative life. He was kind of a voyeur, looking at all the wilder things that go on and that went on in Paris in that time. That's the Paris of Picasso, though that's not an artist that interested Hopper. He went back. He stayed from the autumn of 1906 through June of 1907. He traveled to England and to Amsterdam and Berlin, never went to Italy. He went back to Europe in 1909, briefly to Paris, and again in 1910, but mainly the painting was done on the first trip. And in 1910, the difference was that he did go to Madrid. He went to Spain, in addition to Paris. He lived in Greenwich Village from 1913, and once he moved into that Washington Square North address, he changed apartments in the same building, but he never moved away. He died in that building, in his own studio. But a lot is going to go on. He took up etching, printmaking in 1915, but he was supporting himself as a commercial illustrator. Remember, he studied that for 2 years. And he won, his first recognition was as an illustrator. It was for a World War I poster. And it really was a kind of inside job because he was already illustrating for the magazine that held the contest. But before they could reproduce the poster, happily the war was over. Maybe not happily for Hopper. In 1923, in the taking an artist vacation, that is painting in a summer artist colony in Gloucester, Massachusetts on Cape Ann, he ran into a former classmate, somebody he knew from the New York School of Art, named Josephine Nivison, or Joe Nivison. And while Edward and she went on some sketching trips together, she got him to take up painting in watercolor, something he had done as a boy but given up because he was something he used in commercial illustration. And by the way, he hated to be an illustrator. Well, she was invited to be in a show at the Brooklyn Museum, a watercolor show, and she asked them to consider the work of her neighbor, Edward Hopper. And this was a very important show, and they told him to bring some of his watercolors over to the museum, which he did on the subway. And they put up six of his next to six of Joe's. And Edwards won the purchase prize. We'll see that watercolor later. And he wanted to go back and paint with her again in Gloucester. She would have nothing of it. She wanted to go to Provincetown and on the outer reaches of Cape Cod, where she'd been the previous summer before Gloucester. And that was too bohemian for Edward. They had a spat. And he finally settled their differences by saying, look, Joe, we'll go back to Gloucester, but it'll be our honeymoon. She was 41 years old and he was 42, and they married. And they remained an artist couple. She became his only model. She kept all of his record books whenever anything was going out on loan or for sale or left the studio as a gift. And yet she tried to continue her own career as an artist while he wanted her to stop painting. He didn't believe in women artists. She inherited, well, they went to Cape Cod, to South Truro, which is not as far out as Provincetown, either, well, metaphorically not as far out nor geographically. And they rented a cottage there on a farm. And they did that for several summers. And then in 1934, they built there after he had had a successful retrospective exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. His career, even in the Depression, was doing very well. And so Joe inherited a little money from an uncle. And they built a three-room house overlooking the bay in South Truro. And they spent half of every year there for the basically the rest of their life. And then nothing much changes. Edward kept painting, kept nagging Joe to stop trying to be an artist. He kept painting. They took long car trips to California, to Mexico, to Vermont, looking for subjects because he felt he had painted everything around Cape Cod. Of course, every now and then he would find or make up something. And he, as I say, he died in a studio in 1967. Joe lived less than a year later, and she left a bequest of his artistic estate and most of her own to the Whitney Museum of American Art, which discarded most of her canvases. Okay, so that's the biography. And we see here Edward's watercolor from 1946, Joe in Wyoming. Edward would use the automobile as a mobile studio he would push the front seat up as far as it could go, and Joe is sitting there on the right sketching Mount Moran. So we see him painting her painting, being an artist. He also painted Mount Moran. He was almost 6'5", and he would stretch his long legs across the back. And so he's working from the vantage point of the back seat. By the way, he did not like Joe to drive. He almost never let her drive. And that was another bone of contention between the two of them. Though when he got his first car in 1927, they took driving lessons together. You can read about all this in my biography. So Joe, mind you, thought that Edward was the most important painter in America. And she certainly supported his work. And as I said, his only companion, she was very chatty, always talking. And Edward was very introverted, quiet, even depressive. Joe said that talking to Eddie was like throwing a stone in a well, but it never went kerplop. So now you might ask your students to look at a painting like this by Edward Hopper called New York Corner, because he showed it in 1914, early 1914, at an exhibition in the McDowell Club in New York City. And Richard, you've seen this painting. I showed it to you before, right?
Yes.
You can hear me. I was worried. I'm chatting away. So I would like our participants to think about this painting and how it would be received in 1913 New York. Edward had two paintings in this exhibition. Now, this is a non-juried exhibition, very different than the fancy National Academy of Design. And a lot of students around Robert Henry, or former students, including Edward Hopper, would get together as groups and have an exhibition together, sometimes work on papers, sometimes canvases. So Hopper had New York Corner and this painting, much larger, called Soir Bleu, which means literally blue evening, though he gave it only a French title, never American. Never English, no translation. And I would like to ask our participants which of the two paintings, if they were critics in 1914, which one would they have preferred? Now, the critics had a strong opinion about which of these was the better painting. And I'm wondering which one you prefer and if you think the critics agreed with you.
Okay.
Now, just a minute at the two pictures while you're making up your mind. In New York Corner, there are probably more people than in any other Hopper painting. He didn't like crowds later on. Remember, he's kind of introverted. And in Soir Bleu, what's going on in Soir Bleu? What do you think? Who are these people? And they're obviously in some kind of a cafe situation. What are they doing there? And who are they?
Okay, Gail, we've got some responses coming in thus far. New York Corner is winning. Mike West writes, I like the creepy smoking clown. Yeah, that's great. That's almost like the clown in The Simpsons.
Seems more mysterious. That is true. I would like to ask those of you who prefer New York Corner, what is it about it that you prefer?
What is it about it that we prefer? While our participants are writing in, we might note who Robert Henry was. I mean, he was the sort of the father of the Ashcan school. Is that not right, Gail?
That's right. And he has a funny sounding name, Henri, not pronounced Henri like the French photographer Florence Henri, mm-hmm. because his real name was Robert Henry Cozad, and he was from, I think it was Nebraska. He got into some kind of a barroom brawl and he killed someone.
Oh.
I don't know if it was his fault or why, but he fled to New Jersey with his family and he was kind of in hiding and he gave his sons different names, their middle names. And so Robert Henry Cozad became Robert Henry.
Wow. Hiding out in New Jersey. So, all right, now we've got some people coming in here. Soir Bleu is catching up. Mary Orbendorfer writes about street corner. It's an average street scene depicting a barbershop and individuals passing on the street, easily relatable. Yes, I think we're going to hear, I think a lot of Hopper's paintings are relatable. Bottom one is ominous, makes me think of the Titanic. Like the cafe scene, due to the expression on the faces and the details of the details which the other painting lacks. Street corner, another vote for street corner. I like the contrast of the grand buildings and industry in the background. I like the contrast in color. He made buildings more important than the people. The window shades half open get my attention. It's as if people are spying on the people in the street. Yes, Catherine writes, I also like New York corner because it seems to capture the factory in the background and a busy corner. I bet the critics preferred Suave Blue because of the Carabelle setting in the... Cabaret setting in the front, and Diane likes the cafe scene. Okay, Gail, what did the critics think?
I want to say that our participants are a diverse group, which is great. And those that like Suave Bleu, I think that it is the superior painting, but the critics didn't like it at all. They said it was an overly ambitious French fantasy, and they preferred the smaller New York corner that seemed to capture New York. And now I'd like to look for a moment at Suave Bleu, because if you see the woman with the very painted face standing in the with the low-cut dress, you might ask, what's she doing there? And Hopper left us with a clue. The man on the far left hand with the cap and the cigarette, there's a study drawing for him. That's the only study drawing for this painting that survives. And it's captioned a macro. And a macro, that translates as a mackerel, that fish. Picasso used the same slang, and it's a slang for a pimp, a man who's selling the services of a prostitute. So I have to imagine that that heavily painted lady represents a prostitute, and many of Hopper's watercolors from Paris depicted different types of prostitutes, like La Pierreuse, the woman who pounds the pavement stone. And we see a kind of artist stereotype, the guy in the beret with the cigarette. Tell your students that Hopper is depicting kind of low life and they shouldn't smoke. They didn't know that then. The soldier with the epaulettes we see, and a kind of Jimmy Mondaine, a couple, and then there's the clown. And I have to say that clown with the bald head is almost predictive. It looks a lot like Edward Hopper's going to look later on in life, but he didn't look that way yet.
Gail, we have some interesting questions here. Jennifer notes the guy in the beret looks a little bit like Van Gogh, and then we have a question earlier about influence of Van Gogh. Was Hopper at all influenced by Van Gogh at all?
He never said so, but I believe so. However, rather than tell you which painting I think had a major that Van Gogh had a major impact on, I'm going to wait till that comes up in our sequence tonight and let the participants pick it out.
Okay, great.
But yes, I have written that Van Gogh, a particular well-known Van Gogh, must have influenced Hopper. And of course, Van Gogh was on view in New York in the time that Hopper was painting. Mm-hmm. And there was a major patron of Hopper's work who also collected Van Gogh. Now, I just want to mention, I told you that Hopper took up printmaking, etching, and dry point, another kind of intaglio print, or the kind you dig into a metal plate and ink, in 1915. So by 1921, he'd gotten pretty good at it. And this one was really a prize winner. It's one of my favorites and one of his prize-winning etchings. It's called Evening Wind. And you're going to see the curtains blowing like this in a Hopper painting before too long. It's related to a man named John Sloan, who's part of the Ashcan School. But Hopper was very good at this. And this is the work that he got really the first recognition as a fine artist was as an etcher. Now, the first really recognition that he got as a painter was with his watercolors. And remember that he went on sketching expedition and Joe got him to take up watercolor in Gloucester. This is one of the watercolors that he painted. This is one of the ones he carried over on the subway to Brooklyn, to the Brooklyn Museum. This is one they put in the show. This is the one they gave the entire purchase prize for the whole show to Hopper. So this launched his career as a painter. Before that, he had been submitting oil paintings to the National Academy of Design jury, along with, for example, his classmate George Bellows, who got accepted, but Hopper did not. So later in the 1930s, when the National Academy of Design offered to make Hopper a member, he turned them down. He got a lot of publicity for that, but he was bitter for the fact that they had rejected his paintings. But this one got a prize, and after that, Hopper took his watercolors. He was more confident to the Frank Wren Gallery. He showed them some of his watercolors. Frank Wren, the gallery owner, agreed to give Hopper a show, and the entire show of watercolors sold out. Hopper, that was in 1924, the year he married Joe. Everything was going well for Hopper.
Gail, if I could interrupt, we have some questions and comments here. On the previous etching, Evening Winds, was that the title? Yes. People have asked, is this Hopper's wife?
No, it wouldn't be Hopper's wife, and I can't tell you who it is, although I have my theory. Hopper's wife, he hadn't really become an item with her until 1923 in Gloucester. This is 1921, and so it's definitely not her. Now, Hopper was going to the Whitney Studio Club to sketch in a life model class. In other words, a life drawing, a group of artists would come and they'd each pay 25 cents and they would get a nude, female nude model. And there are Peggy Bacon, for example, a woman artist, depicted Hopper at one of those groups in one of her prints. So this may be a woman named Jean Cherouis, whom Hopper depicted in some other etchings and named, but those she had her clothes on. So I can't tell you if it's the same woman. We don't see her face.
Okay.
Fantasy.
Okay, and we've had some folks commenting on the blowing curtains, which we're going to see again, and we've also identified some themes, windows and voyeurism. Gail Carter asks, why do you think this one, the next painting, Mansard Roof, why it was the winner? And we also have some folks who say it reminds them of Charleston. And when I first saw this painting, it reminded me of Charleston in the Low Country as well.
When Hopper went to Charleston in 1929, he found architecture to paint watercolors of that he liked.
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry, I don't have any here tonight, but in my catalog raisonne or the volume of complete watercolors or in Edward Hopper, The Art and the Artist, or any of books on Hopper, you can't. Oh, I know. My book, Hopper's Places, has watercolors Hopper did in Charleston and my photographs juxtaposed of those sites as they exist today. So I think that's the book, Hopper's Places. It's University of California Press. And I think that would be very useful for teaching, especially to see how artists respond to something when they're realist painters. They still make changes, and that's very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we have a question here. What are the sizes of these paintings?
Oh, it's about 11 by 24.
Mm-hmm.
Now, much later, he paints some larger watercolors, but not that large. He's not a very large painter. However, Sois Bleu, the oil, is one of the largest he ever painted. It's about 3 by 6 feet.
And we have a good comment here from Gail Carter. Woman on the Evening Winds, she seems to want to escape to the life outside of the window. Now, that introduces a theme that's going to come up here later on in the webinar. Is Hopper wanting to get outside, or is he content to be inside in the interior?
I did not interpret this the same way, but I do think that Hopper is very interested in interior and exterior and the tension between interior and exterior. In this case, I think the wind is catching her attention.
Yeah.
So she's turning, you know, to the cool breeze.
Uh-huh.
But,
yeah.
You know, Hopper's images are very subject to interpretation. That's what most people do with Hopper's images. They interpret them.
That's great. Gail Carter introduced that theme. Thank you, Gail. Shall we move on? This is one of his most famous paintings.
I want to say that Hopper liked that. He didn't want to tell anyone exactly what his paintings were about. He wanted them to think about it and look at it and figure it out for themselves. So, you know, it's not one answer. Sometimes I think I find his sources, but that's not all they're about. He's doing something else. So here we have House by the Railroad, an oil painting. Unless I say so now, everything's going to be oil on canvas. It has a mansard roof, and if you look at the Pavillon de Flore on the Louvre in Paris, it has a mansard roof. Hopper loved those kinds of roofs like you see here, but it's American Victoriana, really. And it represented for him the kind of architecture in Rockland County, New York, where he grew up, you know, around Nyack. But you notice the railroad tracks running right by this very fine-looking house. And so the house has passed its prime. The railroad has been imposed. And where is the railroad going? Of course, it's going from the small town to the big city, just like Hopper did from Nyack to New York. But I think we have to remember that Hopper was born in 1882 in Victorian times. He came of age right around the turn of the century. His wife was just less than a year younger. She became one of the new women of Greenwich Village, a bit bohemian, but Hopper remained stubbornly the Victorian male with a lot of those societal attitudes. Now, this painting was snapped up by a man that became an important patron for Hopper, Stephen C. Clark, who had inherited the Singer sewing machine fortune. And he donated this painting to the new Museum of Modern Art, which was founded in 1929. And by January 1930, they owned this painting. And it was the first oil painting by any artist anywhere to enter their permanent collection. And of course, they still have it today. And this is the museum that would give Hopper his first retrospective in 1933. It was organized by a man named Alfred Barr Jr., which is ironic because he became the great champion of abstract art by the mid-30s. And in the 1940s, and he was championing abstract expressionism, all that abstract art that Hopper detested. He always maintained realism will always reassert itself. And about that, I think Hopper was correct.
Gail, we're going to talk in a moment. one of our framing questions is about Hopper's relationship to cinema. And several of our participants have already picked up that theme. Jennifer writes, this picture reminds me of the house from Beetlejuice or the house from the Addams Family, alone, isolated on a hill. Mary writes, reminds me of the house in the movie Psycho, a beautiful image. And then we have...
It is the house in Psycho.
And then... you said that Hopper's work invites interpretation. We're already getting into that. There is no movement. Linda notes there is no movement in this one. A lack of vegetation or garden seems odd. And Judith Batten likens this painting, to the photographs of Winston O. Link, the great photographer of trains in southwestern Virginia. And I can see some of that, Judith. And it goes on. This looks almost like a photograph. Like detail, the house is, and here again, we're interpreting the wonderful thematic emphasis here. The house is all alone, almost like being left behind. Reminds me of the farmer's house in Days of Heaven, another movie. I agree with Mary.
Another one that it's definitely the Days of Heaven. Jack Fisk, the set designer of Days of Heaven, admitted that it was this house. Alfred Hitchcock admitted that it was this house. This house was the basis of a model on the lot of Universal Studios out in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. So they're giant, Days of Heaven, Psycho, many, many films have a house based on this house.
So that's made, that perhaps helps to explain why Hopper is so iconic in American culture. And Linda writes, the windows are shut up to create a sense of abandonment. And Gail writes, contrast, lines, strong, horizontal, and vertical. Color, a white except for the chimneys. The base is ruddy, very ordered, structured, symmetrical windows and columns. Feeling grand, but lonely. Older homes, plus contrasted with modern transportation. For some reason, this house also sort of reminds me of the Faulkner story, A Rose for Emily, perhaps because I've just been working on that. But in any event, we've got a lot of really fine art critics in this audience tonight, Gail.
You know, I did a little anthology. I think it's called Silent Places or something like that. It's out of print. You can find it on the internet. There are two anthologies that teachers might really enjoy with their students. One is poetry about Hopper, and the other is excerpts from fiction about Hopper. And of course, his impact on cinema we've been talking about, on film directors, but it came very naturally for film directors to enjoy Hopper, because when he was quite young already, around when he was struggling, and when he was working as an illustrator in the mid-teens, he was working, he was actually paid a quarter, an hour, I think, to watch movies. And he was working on making posters for the French cinema house called Eclair. Unfortunately, all of those posters and all of those movies seem to have been destroyed, but we have Hopper record books that document the films that he illustrated posters for.
Okay, well, shall we move ahead?
Here's a very cinematic Hopper painting, which is also at the Museum of Modern Art, Night Windows, and it's almost like we're on a close-up crane, you know, looking in. Hopper maybe looked in from the L train passing by. That's how he got. And you can imagine yourself in Hopper's point of view, and there's that curtain blowing in the wind. And it's not, there's not a female nude, but there's a female in a state of undress. And Hopper doesn't tell us the whole story here again. It's just suggestive.
Well, we have another film reference, Hitchcock's Rear Window. And then one of our participants writes, his little pops of red and orange to attract attention, very much an illustrator's tool and use of complementary colors. Again, the theme of voyeurism, that really seems to run through his paintings.
That's Hopper. Working on Hopper taught me, I live in New York City, to close my blinds as soon as I turn on the lights at night.
And we have another interesting comment here. He likes corners, too. That's true. Yes. If you look at Nighthawks, there's that very sharp, distinct corner at the edge of the cafe. Any particular... what's your take on that, Gail? Why corners? I mean, it's because perspective? I don't know.
Visually interesting.
Yeah, okay.
Likes an angle looking down a lot of time, and he mm-hmm. admired the work of Edgar Degas, the French Impressionist. He also, by the way, Night Windows, the illumination, he loved Rembrandt's Night Watch, which he saw in Amsterdam when he was in Europe mm-hmm. in 1907.
Okay, and then Mary Oberndorfer brings out the theme of mystery in Hopper. You never know what is around the corner. That is true. And you don't know if there's someone else in that room who is hidden by those by the walls.
So yeah, you can all think about Hopper's paintings as one frame out of a movie. You don't know what comes before or after. So it's always very suggestive and also very mysterious. You don't really know what's going to happen or what's already happened. You just know what's in the moment.
Yeah, that's a really good way of thinking of his paintings as a frame in a movie. Yeah, that's wonderful. Well, shall we move ahead then? Let's take a look at Tables for Ladies.
So I'd like to ask our participants if they know what this title suggests, Tables for Ladies. and then what's going on in the picture.
Okay.
And the painting was acquired right after it was painted by the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and it's still there today. You can go and see it when you're in New York. And I want to point out, you see the checkerboard floor and how we're looking down on it from our point of view. And you can find similar checkerboard floors in paintings from the 17th century in the Netherlands by an artist called Jan Steen, for example. That's Steen. So do we have any answers?
Well, we have tea time for the well-to-do, but nothing but work for lower-class females. Ah, nice contrast there between the lady at the table and the woman at the cashier and the waitress. Let's see what else we have. So, yeah, so...
I pointed out that Hopper was a real Victorian man with Victorian male values, and Hopper had one older sister, one sibling, Marion, just 2 years older. And, you know, when she would want to go out, she couldn't go out by herself. She had to go out with a chaperone. She was from a proper family. So if you're thinking around, you know, 1900, long dresses and chaperones.
Well, Karen writes, a table for ladies suggests a restaurant that is okay for ladies to enter as opposed to other less socially acceptable places. Cafe lunch, social meetings, or clandestine meetings. Strong border and barrier of the low wall and fruit. So, are we on the right track here?
Karen really has it for the title. And I was, you know, I thought that was what it was. And once when I was out in, I think it was Arizona, I was in a flea market. I was going through old photographs. And I found one of a soldier in a World War I American soldier uniform. And there was a billboard in the background with one of those pointing hands and a sign, tables for ladies. And it was clearly the kind of restaurant where women in a group or in a couple of women or even maybe a lone woman could go without being thought to be like the painted lady prostitute in Swableur. So Edward was very sensitive to this. But there are lots of other clues, and the barrier with the low wall and the fruit. Notice it's not just the fruit, and fruit is a symbol of fecundity and kind of eroticism since Aristotle. But we've also got those chops, the meat on the platter. And that makes us think of, you know, relishing that expression, licking one's chops. But in the Metropolitan Museum, there's a Dutch 17th century painting by Frans Hals, a barroom scene with a woman with sausages and some men gathered around her making not very nice gestures with their hands. So there's a sort of erotic, suggestive element that Hopper's making. The woman is bending over. We're looking at her, by the way, through a plate glass window. So there's the tension between interior and exterior space again.
Mm-hmm. You know, maybe that's why Hopper has lent himself to so much movies, because you do have this emphasis on the act of viewing, of looking. You're aware that you're looking where maybe you shouldn't be looking.
And here's another example, Room in New York. And of course, we're talking about New York City. And people don't live so much in houses with little lawns in Manhattan. They live in apartment buildings for the most part, or, you know, multiple family units. And here again, it's like we're on a camera. If you've ever seen pictures of how Hitchcock shot Rear Window, it's a lot like this. And notice the paintings within the paintings hanging on the wall. You'll find them in Edgar Degas' work. It's something that Hopper clearly absorbed. But I think the most interesting thing here is the tension between the couple. Hopper has now been married 8 years. Remember, he's very introverted, so he's always often reading, and Joe would like to talk, and he doesn't have anything to say. And here the woman is trying to get the man's attention. Or it looks like she is. She's going to make music or noise with the piano. So it's pretty... I think emblematic of their domestic arrangements.
Mm-hmm. I think the color is interesting here, too. I mean, the woman is in a red dress, suggestive of passion. We're going to see that later on. women in perhaps seductive poses or moods, facing men who seem to be very uninterested.
The tension between the couples in Hopper paintings will augment from this point on.
You know what struck me about that, this painting? The title Room really deflects from what's going on. I mean, this really isn't about a room. This is about a couple. How often was he deliberately, or was he being deliberately ironic with his titles? Was he trying to deflect us?
Room, if you think about room meaning an enclosed space where you're stuck with somebody else. A New York apartment is just, maybe you only have a studio apartment, or maybe you have only two rooms. You know, a room in New York is, there's a lot less elbow room than there is somewhere else. In other words, people might live in very small spaces. Mm-hmm. There's nowhere he can go.
He wants
to get away from the music.
Well, we have one of our participants noted that they're doing their own thing, but they're together. And they are doing their own thing, but I wouldn't say they're together. I mean, she seems to want to be together, but he is not having any of it.
Yeah, so they're in the same room, in the same space. There's a gulf between them.
Yeah. Okay, we have about 30 minutes left to go. Normally, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to run over tonight because of our technological problems at the outset, so please bear with us. Okay, let's take a look at Shakespeare at Dusk.
So this is really special. What do you think about what time of day it is, what season of the year, and where is it? I'll let you know that. It's in Central Park in Manhattan. That's the statue of Shakespeare seen from behind. It's going to be sunset, not sunrise, the way it's, you know, looking west. And you can tell me the season. So, clearly, it's autumn. So why is Hopper painting Shakespeare? The title tells you this, the time of day, dusk, sunset. And sunset dusk is always the end of something. Why is Hopper painting Shakespeare at dusk at this particular moment? What has happened? And I've been trying to emphasize that I believe the paintings are often autobiographical. Hopper's mother had just died, and he was very close with his mother, who really supported his creative ambition. So I would like you to look, some of you must know Shakespeare's sonnet number 73, that time of year thou mayest in me behold, when yellow leaves or none or few do hang, upon the boughs which shake against the cold, bare ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. So deep into autumn, in me thou seest twilight of such day, as the sunset fadeth in the west, which by and by black night doth take away death's second self that seals up all the rest. So it's a sonnet about dusk, sunset, autumn being the end of this of the growing season, and death. And it's using the time of day and autumn as metaphor for death. And Edward is very sad at the loss of his mother. And of course, he loved the theater. Robert Henri sent his students to the theater. And so he had great respect and love for Shakespeare.
One of our participants, Gail, noted the prominence of the U.S. sign. How do we interpret that?
Well, I think it must be United States. I guess you can say it's also us. I mean,
yeah.
Is that Eddie and his mother? I hadn't thought of that before, but if you wanted to carry it to that extreme, I suppose you could. Now, let me emphasize that I only know that Hopper painted this right after his mother died. Neither Hopper nor Joe said, this is a painting about the death of his mother. This is my interpretation. I think it's pretty solid.
Yes, it convinced me.
The next summer, they're at the seashore at their house in Cape Cod, and I just want to show you a slightly larger watercolor, but a watercolor in a slightly evolved style. But what I think is so interesting, it's the buildings are all still there, and you'll find the photograph in my book, Hopper's Places, that I mentioned earlier. And I wondered, you know, how would little shacks like this survive? Well, it's in the National Seashore, very near to, you know, in Truro. And so if people would tear down these buildings, they would have no permission to build them back up. It's restricted. So they are grandfathered in, as it were. And of course, typical Hopper, no people. Well, here is another painting from the Museum of Modern Art's Hopper collection, and it's New York Movie. It's interesting because that's Joe posing for all the figures. And does anybody know what movie this appears in? It's actually one of the film frames in a movie. I'll give you a clue, from the 1980s, early 80s. And there are more than 50 drawings in at least 5 different movie theaters extant for this painting. And so it's not just we saw how film directors used Hopper's House by the Railroad, but and this one too, but Hopper loved the movies. And so many times, Hopper didn't make that many oil paintings. He would get what I call painter's block, very much like writer's block, which is a more common expression. And he would just not be able to find anything to paint. And he would get very depressed. And sometimes he would say he would just go on a, he would go to the movies and he would go on a regular movie binge and he would go to movie after movie. In those days, I think you could go to a movie house and they would change the movie and you could see more than one for the same price. He was very frugal.
We have another film reference here. Stephanie Collins writes, Mr. Deeds goes on vacation, referring to the previous picture, the one on Cape Cod. And then we have Mary writing that the figure on the right is a very pensive figure. And 1939 was, of course, the year for Gone with the Wind. Gail, one of our framing questions is how does Hopper's paintings reflect, how does his paintings reflect the times in which they were painted? You just mentioned that he was a binge watcher of movies, and in the 30s, 1939, this is the Great Depression, of course, and of course, lots of people with no work spent a lot of time in movie theaters just to occupy their time. How much does the Great Depression enter into this picture at all?
Well, for Hopper in general, he did not suffer that much in the Depression because his career really took off about 1930. The Whitney Museum bought Early Sunday Morning. The Metropolitan bought Tables for Ladies. The Museum of Modern Art was buying his work. They gave him a show in 1933. Mm-hmm. Only about around 1937 does Hopper even feel the pinch of the Depression for a short time. In fact, he was offered a mural commission. You know, we had many federal art programs, and he was offered a mural commission. He turned it down. He didn't believe in the New Deal. Hopper is, you know, most artists are kind of liberal. Hopper was kind of more conservative. He had had to struggle as an illustrator, and he didn't believe in government, what he would have called government handouts. But he had many artists and writers and theater people starving and unable to find patrons or work during the Depression. And you have the Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal and many programs for artists. Hopper wouldn't have anything to do with any of them, even when he was offered by the Treasury Department a mural commission. So some people have read social interpretations of Hopper's paintings, you know, on the left that would not really be correct.
Right. So Mary's comment here about 1939 being the beginning of World War II, heightened militarism, our usherette here on the right probably is not worried about, she's not agonizing over the world situation.
I think maybe she's lost in her own thoughts or bored having seen the movie too many times. Let's see. You know, the war started in 39, but it's not, America's not yet in the war. And let's just look for a moment at Office at Night in 1940. And Hopper's really interested, I think, here in the relationship between the secretary and her boss. And all he would say about this painting is that it has three sources of light. Outside light, the desk light, and the overhead light. That's pretty minimal, right? But Joe in the record books call the room confidentially yours, room such and such, a number she gave. And she talked about, she posed, the tight dress she wore, and the high-heeled pumps. So, but by the way, I've written about this elsewhere. There's a lot of influence from Edgar Degas. And he did a painting in America. You know, he came to New Orleans and painted the cotton market. And those doors on the left and even the kind of office furniture appear in that painting. And Hopper's drawings for this painting reveal a much closer relationship to Degas than he left in the final painting.
Mm-hmm.
But now
does he
painting, yeah.
Was he one of the first painters to paint office spaces? I mean, that is not usually thought of as being an artistic inspiration.
It's a very unusual subject. Hopper, as an illustrator, had actually been working for System Magazine, which was a precursor of the magazine Business Week. I think that may still be in existence. I'm not sure, but it certainly has been around in my lifetime. And he painted many of these same themes. Hopper drew many of these same themes as an illustrator. And while he hated being an illustrator, according to what he said, he did learn some useful tricks and some ideas. And I think the way Hopper's paintings are very reductive of detail has to do with the fact that he had to turn out these illustrations.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't reproduce, you know, they're not all the details of a Jan van Eyck, for example.
Right. You know, that may be why he is so iconic. I mean, we've all spent time in an office. We've all spent time in movie theaters. And he was an American painter who chose to paint about these very commonplace American spaces. Not the Great Prairies, you know, not the Rockies and all, but places that we all end up in at time to time. Our offices don't look like that anymore, but we've all spent time in an office somewhere.
Yeah, it's true, Richard. You know, Hopper said it took him 20 years to get over Europe. And he said he painted the people called him an American scene painter. He said, no, I paint what's around me. And he had no desire to go back to Europe because he was afraid to fly. And he didn't want to spend all that time on a boat. So when he wanted to go out of the U.S., the only place he and Joe went was in the automobile to Mexico. Well, they went to the American West and they drove to Mexico.
Mm-hmm. Well, Gail Carter notes here again, the man is focused on his work. The shapely woman is focused on the man. Their desks are close together, but his mind is far off. So again, two people together in a room, but alone.
Now, I see someone's referring to Norman Rockwell. And while his work is very realistic and representational, Rockwell just loved to work on commission. And Hopper hated being an illustrator. And he, you know, he actually got a commission from Helen Hayes and Charles MacArthur to do a painting of their house in Nyack, which is called Pretty Penny. It's in the Smith College Art Museum collection. And he didn't want to accept it. And that was during the 30s, during the Depression. And his wife and his dealer wanted the money. And Hopper wanted to say no to, of course, the actress Helen Hayes. But he went up there and she said he was the grumpiest man she ever met.
Well, Jennifer makes a good comment here. Office at Night, the furniture reminds me of newspaper rooms or police offices more than just an office. So she's right. You do have this kind of whiff of bureaucracy in that painting. And again, we've all bumped into bureaucracy as part of American life.
Yes. Well, because you will find, you know, offices, by the way, like Indigo I've mentioned, and Quentin Metsy's, you know, going way back. But there it'll be the Money Changer. So, but there's very few. I've actually written an essay on it. By the way, I think it's the first, I have a website with many free articles, actually in full text on my website on Hopper and other subjects.
And we have given the participants that URL. And one more comment on this painting. Again, you have that element of mystery and questioning, that typewriter on the lower left-hand corner. Obviously, somebody else is supposed to be in this office. That person is not there. Raises all kinds of questions. What do they do here? Why are they alone together at night? Just another wonderful, mysterious painting from Hopper.
Right. But as somebody says, didn't he hate the WPA? He sure did. He didn't want to have anything to do with it.
We come to the masterpiece.
Yes, but now, Nighthawks. First of all, when it was painted, Arnold Newman actually went to photograph Hopper in November of 1941. And Hopper, Arnold Newman, the great photographer, will like to take his subjects next to one of their recently completed artworks. And Edward had already sent everything to his gallery. He was that successful. He could sell everything he was making. He didn't want to pose with some old painting. So he posed with a blank canvas, the same canvas that became Nighthawks. And it's late November. He couldn't come up with a subject. We know this from Joe's diary. And so what happened in early December, 1941, you all know, that was the bombing of Pearl Harbor and the beginning of the U.S. entry into World War II. And Joe was absolutely terrified. They lived Washington Square North. By now they had the top floor with skylights. And there was a blackout program. You had to not let anyone see your light at night because they were afraid of people bombing New York. And Joe was specifically worried that the Nazis were going to come and bomb New York. She kept a rucksack, a little knapsack packed in case they had to evacuate. Edward wouldn't pay any attention to this. He was busily painting Nighthawks. He finished it by the end of January, 1942. And the Art Institute of Chicago bought it almost immediately. And Richard, you've mentioned that it's one of the most famous American paintings in the 20th century. And the other most famous iconic image, I was asking you what you thought that was, Richard, and you said, remember?
It was American Gothic, Grant Wood's.
Yeah, by Grant Wood. And those are both in the Art Institute of Chicago. That's 1930, both bought soon after they were painted. So they're in this major museum in America's heartland, often reproduced. But by now, there are so many parodies of Nighthawks. People have made Christmas cards with Santa and his reindeer, Duck Hawks with, you know, Donald Duck. There's a German artist that made a parody with Marilyn Monroe, Elvis Presley, Humphrey Bogart, and James Dean. So, it just goes on and on. And this is a painting which appears in so many movies, in Wim Wenders, I think that Hopper actually got his idea for this in part from movies that he saw, film noir, but also now, what painting uses red, green, yellow light and depicts a night, a restaurant or a cafe at night? Knows that among our participants.
Okay, what painting uses those colors and depicts a cafe at night?
As people or a near empty cafe in the night.
Okay, while we're waiting for that, we have some really interesting comments coming in here. One of our participants writes, Nighthawks is like a Vincent van Gogh, use of complementary colors, lighting, van Gogh. Blue, orange, and Hopper, red and green. I feel like Hopper is spying on people a lot in his paintings. The men
that's
are...
That's what I'm talking about, Richard Van Gogh's Night Cafe.
That was night,
That's what she's talking about. She's got it. And
good.
Hopper's major patron, the one that gave the house by the railroad to the Museum of Modern Art, Stephen C. Clark, owned Van Gogh's Night Cafe, and he gave it to Yale University. And he was constantly collecting Hopper. He gave many Hoppers to Yale University's art gallery.
Mm-hmm. So we have a number of comments. The men are in work attire. It is late. They chose to linger in a diner rather than go home. Let's see. It's like the cafe is like a refuge. The street is deserted. A movie noir only in color. One of our participants noted that Turner Classic Movie has an advertisement to lead into their main feature of the night, which really does reflect. In fact, this picture, but it also reflects other Hopper paintings. The diner.
There is several Simpson episodes with this parody. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And
this sense of unease of people being out in the night—that's the unease after Pearl Harbor.
Uh-huh.
It's the unease that we can feel in the times we're living in too.
One participant writes up, my students recognize the invitation on the Simpsons. So people are learning from all sorts of different sources.
I think
one of the things that makes Hopper so iconic is that his paintings are accessible, but they're, once you access them, they still offer so much to think about. They're not accessible in an easy, sentimental way where they telegraph you their meaning. You can, as you said earlier, they are heavily interpreted, and they just call for interpretation and offer us so much to talk about and think about and speculate on. I think that's maybe one reason why they're so popular.
Speaking of that, Richard, our participants might want to have an assignment where they have their students read Ernest Hemingway's short story, The Killers.
Mm-hmm.
It's about people meeting in a night cafe, and they're planning a murder, but nothing ever happens. And that's like Hopper, because it's the frame out of the film, nothing ever happens. And then there's the film by Robert Siedemark of after Hemingway's The Killers. And that's got scenes like this also. So there, and not only that, we know that Hopper loved Hemingway's short stories, The Killer, because he thought he discovered Hemingway. Hopper's last illustrations were for Scribner's magazine. And he actually wrote a letter to Scribner's telling him that Hemingway was a much better writer than the usual saccharine stuff that they were publishing.
Yeah. And also, I mean, you mentioned Hemingway, The Killers, certainly this is evocative of The Killers, but also for me, A Clean, Well-Lighted Place. I mean, every time I think, look at this painting, I think of that. We have Gail Carter asking a question here. Note the name of the venue, Philly's. What do we make of that, Gail?
Oh, that's Philly's cigars. That's absolutely Philly's cigars. In parodies, people use it to refer sometimes in newspaper cartoons. I have a whole collection. They've referred to the Phillies ball team, and it's been changed to many products. Hopper occasionally, you know, that's the old illustrator, and he's picking up advertising signs in many of his paintings.
Mm-hmm. Well, shall we move ahead?
We spend all night on Nighthawks, but we won't. So here's a weird one. It's kind of like, you know, the old architecture around Rockland County, but it's not. He tells us it's Pennsylvania coal town. And remember, Hopper did drive west, but here we are in 1947, and we've got a man with a rake. Strange, Hopper. We can think of, you know, the French Jean Millet, man with a hoe, and Hopper sketched that as an art student. But we have this very Italianate garden ornament with a plant in it, very unusual in a Hopper. And this one, I think, has a literary reference. I was very puzzled by it when I was studying Hopper at first. And I had read Hopper was asked about a number of Midwestern writers. And the only one that he said he liked was Sherwood Anderson. Well, Sherwood Anderson turns out to have written a novel in 1917 about a town called Coal Creek, which he called hideous, a town in Pennsylvania. So when I found that out, I immediately started to read this novel, and I came across this passage when a strike came on about this man. He was told by the mine manager to go on back to work or to move out of the house, which he rented from the mine. He thought of the garden and of the work he had done and went back to his routine of work in the mine. While he worked, the miners marched up the hill and destroyed the garden. The next day, the Italian also joined the striking miners. So I found that very suggestive. Mm-hmm. Where the title Pennsylvania Coal Town came from. There's also, Joe makes a reference to the guy in the record books or her diaries as a Pole, and there in the novel is a reference to Polish immigrants, and of course, but the garden ornament is very Italianate, and so that's the Italian.
Once again, a Hopper painting inviting interpretation. Jennifer writes, that pause in activity, looking into the distance, something happened. So he just invites, the pictures are so mysterious, they invite so much speculation.
Yes. Yes, they're wonderful for students to write about.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'd like to ask our participants, and you might ask your students, what's going on in America in 1949 that could be depicted in this painting, or that someone could think was being depicted in this painting? Actually, it's a lot like a Dutch painting with the light coming in from the window and the beams on the ceiling. But if your husband brought this painting home to you to hang in your house, would you send it back? That's what Mrs. Stephen C. Clarke did. She didn't like it. And Stephen C. Clarke is the one that owned Van Gogh's Night Cafe. He later bought a painting called Sunlight in a Cafeteria, Rooms by the Sea. And he's the one that gave House by the Railroad to the Museum of Modern Art. So why did Mrs. Clarke want to return this painting? She had a very specific objection. Anybody got an idea?
Anybody got an idea? What's going on in 1949? The Cold War HUAC investigation seems like questioning.
Ah, early Cold War, House on American Activities. Yes, that's it. She thought that this looked like a communist meeting. She didn't want to have any of that in her house. On the other hand, the sunlight, I want to mention, Hopper loved to paint sunlight. He said he hated to draw people grimacing and gesturing. What he really wanted to paint is sunlight on the side of a house.
Mm-hmm. Well, once again, in there we have a setting that is very unartistic. I mean, that's, if we could go back to that for a moment, Gail, that looks like you'd mentioned that the flat objects there to the left are bolts of cloth. So this perhaps is a cutting, well, I don't know if it's a cutting room or... I don't exactly know what it is, but it is obviously a place of business.
Yeah. Yes. And, you know, there was probably some left-wing activity mm-hmm. going on in the garment industry with unions, but there was certainly the McCarthy and the Red Scares. You know, there's all kinds of accusations of people being communists. And mm-hmm. Mrs. Stephen C. Clarke, what did she know from a communist? But it's the mystery of Hopper that made her uneasy, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we have Gail Carter makes a comment, the woman is an equal comrade dressed in the same colors as the men.
Maybe that's what set off Mrs. Clarke.
A comrade, there you go. A loaded word in 1949.
Very good. So here we have another intimate scene, and I promised you the couples would become less and less tender. So Hopper's painting Joe now, making her look kind of old and more haggard, but she's lost in her reading. But in the record book, she recorded a comment from Hopper or maybe from her. Anyway, she recorded the comment, she'd better keep an eye on her husband. He wishes he were somewhere else. And of course, there are the railroad tracks suggesting moving on outside the window. I like the reflection of a light in the window.
Yeah, we have, Mary writes, a wistful gaze outward. Yeah, that desire to escape. And again, another very noir scene. I mean, you can see this easily in a film
very
noir.
Yeah.
The only thing missing would be a flashing, the light of a flashing neon sign, you know. The woman is ignoring the man this time. Yeah. So they're both ignoring each other.
She's not ignoring Richard. Here in 4-lane road, she's, what's she doing?
Hey, what do we make of this one? What is the significance of the road and the gas station have for Hopper? I don't know if Hopper meant this to be humorous, but it is a kind of funny picture. I mean, funny, it has some wit to it here. The poor man's, you know, enduring the hectoring of his wife.
Joe made the comment in her diary. She said she did not pose for this one. Hopper did not use models. I mean, obviously he knew the figure well enough. She said he's making that woman look like an ugly shrike, that's kind of bird, because he's so angry at me. They had a lot of spats.
Mm-hmm.
I think they had abiding love for each other, but they had a number of differences, and temperamental differences, to be sure. And also, they were a couple that were really together 24/7. They never really had a break. And then they would take these interminable car trips, you know, where they're just with each other and maybe the radio.
Mm-hmm. Again, to address one of our framing questions, how does Hopper's work reflect the period in which they were painted? here, Mike West writes, the contrast between the sitting on the chair and the fast pace of transportation in the 1950s. Judith Batten writes, life-changing interstate highways. Stephanie Collins writes, the three paintings, couples together, but not really. The wives want attention. The husbands are elsewhere. And another one of our participants noted that at this period, the interstate highway was being built. So this reminds me of the house by the railroad track. I mean, this is a place, an institution that is being passed by modernity. Those are really old-looking pumps. That is a sort of bucolic highway, and that is all being supplanted by the mighty interstate highway system.
Now, Mary Oberndorfer writes, seems like he was generally down on marriage. I wouldn't say that he was down on marriage, more I would say he was down on women. He and some men of this Victorian generation kind of thought women were best unseen and unheard from. You know, they were best behind the scenes. So it's a very old-fashioned view of women. And although he married a contemporary, she had a much more modern view of women. So that's a basis for conflict.
Mm-hmm. And here, Catherine Dorion notes that this painting is set near sunset as well. You've got clouds gathering there in the background. Maybe a storm is brewing.
Also, the man in the chair seems to be waiting. And if we look back, you know, there's a lot of waiting in Hopper. And again, it's that sense of one frame out of the whole film. And we just don't know what happened before and what's going to happen next.
Mm-hmm. And Judith Batten writes, automobiles are an important part of life in the 50s.
Absolutely. And of course, it's another arena for conflict. He won't let Joe drive the car, and they lived a very isolated life on Cape Cod, out in the country, and she would like to drive around and have her art supplies with her when she's painting. Sometimes when he just was stuck and couldn't get an idea, they were driving around and she'd get out and start, and that would really, she would know that it would help him get going. He would help him maybe get his competitive juices flowing, and he would get out and so sometimes they actually painted the same subject from maybe slightly different vantage points, but very, very close at the mm-hmm. same time.
Mm-hmm. Once again, our participants are showing their skills at art criticism. Mary Oberndorfer writes, late middle age, life is set, not much opportunity for change despite desire. Gail Carter writes, transportation, a method of escape, is always near and contemplated. And Linda C. writes, here we are looking at the same relational issues with the lower class as well. Did class issues enter much into Hopper's work?
Well, I think he painted mainly the middle class. Class that he more or less knew and was comfortable with. He's not so much about painting, I don't know if it's class, it's more he had a lot of attitudes toward women if they weren't proper ladies. They were the proper and the improper, and he liked to paint both, but he really noticed the distinction.
Okay, well, shall we move ahead?
I should mention that gas is a major painting at the Museum of Modern Art, and there's a gas station in Orleans on the Cape. So he painted, and there's rodent trees. He painted a lot of highway and gas paintings. Well, this excursion into philosophy is one of two bedroom scenes. It's a very unforgiving bed, and Hopper quipped about the man. He's been reading Plato rather late in life, and you know, it's a very glum couple. This is not a tender or romantic scene. It's one of depression.
Yeah. Maybe another a seduction scene that failed, perhaps.
Yeah. Well, you could read my biography for more about that. Now, Sun in an Empty Room was once said to have a figure, but he painted it out. But look what's left, these beams of sunlight, and look how they flow together. Now, when their handyman on the Cape, on Cape Cod, Tommy Gray, passed away, Edward's comment, which Jo recorded in her diaries, was, poor Tommy Gray, he just can't see the sunlight anymore. And the sunlight, I think, for Hopper was very important. That's what he said he wanted to paint, but he saw it as the life force. And of course, it's sunlight that makes the plants grow. We need sunlight for vitamin D. It's an animating force. But Hopper was, as I said, very tall. Joe was about 5 feet. And I see this as representing the two of them kind of merged together on the Cape, where they had only three rooms, a bedroom, Edward Hopper's studio, the living room, and a kitchen. And Joe was free to paint anywhere but in the studio, and the light was impossible in the other rooms. But here we have Sun in an Empty Room.
Well, we have an interesting comment here from Linda C. Really, all his rooms look empty, whether there is furniture or people. I feel like all the rooms are still empty.
They are very reductive. This is true, and I attribute that to his work as an illustrator. He just saw the basics. But now the color isn't very good on this slide, this reproduction, but look at the theme. Does anybody have an idea what might have inspired the two comedians? Which, by the way, Hopper said represented, he told Joe, that it represented himself and Joe bowing out. And it was painted less than 2 years before he died, so he was already ailing. And he points to her, notice, and he takes her hand. And you notice the costumes? Do they remind you of anything we've seen earlier? Punch and Judy. They actually saw a Punch and Judy show, that's interesting, in Gloucester in 1923 when they were first courting.
Another film illusion, An American in Paris.
Yes. Oh, and I forgot to mention that Joe and Edward were complete francophiles. So you're so right. When they were courting that summer in 1923 in Gloucester, Edward started reciting on, they were sitting on Bass Rocks, and he was reciting a lovely poem about, romantic poem by Verlaine, Paul Verlaine, about the evening. And he was astonished that when he paused, Joe took up the poem and completed it. So we were really, you know, she turns out to have spent time in Paris too. After World War I, she was over there working for the U.S. Army as a civilian, helping with wounded soldiers, sort of occupational therapy. So for their entire 43 years of marriage until Edward's death, his birthday and anniversary cards to Joe were usually books of French poetry and cards that he would make in French. So I find that very charming. The two of them happened to be at the cinema, and they saw a movie, a French movie, about comedians in the Commedia dell'arte, the traveling Italian comedians, which was made in France by Marcel Carnet during the war. It's called Les Enfants du Paradis, or Children of Paradise. They loved the film so much, they sat through it twice. And I believe that it's the theme that inspired this painting. But of course, it's Hopper's tribute to Joe, even though they fought so often. I do believe I loved her, and I certainly couldn't have done without her. She was almost a kind of silent collaborator. And in the end, he lets her up on the stage with him. They bow out together. And of course, we know what happens when the actors bow and take their applause. The curtain goes down, the lights go out, and it's the end of the story. And this brings me to the end of our presentation. But I really hope that you're all going to continue taking an interest in Edward Hopper, and there's just so much you can work with your students.
We have some questions here. Mary Oberndorfer asks about the scale here. These figures seem diminutive in the painting. Is the scale odd here, or is it a point of view question?
Well, I think we're looking from way down in the audience. Mm-hmm. By the way, this was owned, you might be interested to know, by Mr. and Mrs. Frank Sinatra. They were the first owners of this painting. Mm-hmm.
And the book on the poetry of Hopper is that the poetry of solitude.
That is the subtitle, and I forget the exact title. You'll find it easily. I'm the editor, and there'll be used copies on the internet.
So one of our final questions, our framing questions, why are these paintings significant? I think for me, what you taught me tonight here is that Hopper mined his biography for images that speak to us all. I mean, he looked at his own distinct, unique experience and yet was able to translate that into images that have almost universal resonance in the West. Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our webinar. I ask for final questions and comments. Gail, I want to thank you for two things. I want to thank you, first of all, for weathering our technological difficulties with such grace here at the beginning. And I also want to thank you, above all, for giving us a wonderful webinar tonight. This webinar combined the delight of looking at wonderful paintings with the instruction of a real master. So thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And I want to thank our participants.
Their good comments and questions.
Yeah, I mean, we have a whole class here of art critics. Thank you very much. The participation was wonderful. I enjoyed it so much. Now, ladies and gentlemen, our final webinar for this spring season is Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. We're going to be looking at Jack Kerouac's On the Road. Please join us for that. Please don't forget to fill out your evaluation, shoot that to us, and then you'll be able to download your certificate of participation for your recertification credit. Gail, thank you again. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, and good evening.